The topic of our discussion is anti-COVID drugs or the drugs which are used for the treatment of COVID-19. The unprecedented circumstances of the coronavirus disease 2019, that is COVID-19 pandemic, have proven to be particularly challenging due to the lack of well-established therapy and the treatment guidelines. Although highly contagious, infection with severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2, that is SARS-CoV-2, seems to be less virulent than severe acute respiratory syndrome, that is SARS, and Middle East respiratory syndrome, MERS, in the terms of morbidity and mortality. The clinical manifestations of COVID-19 in infected individuals ranges from asymptomatic or mild cases to the critical illness with rapid deterioration and thereby death. As such, the treatment of patients varies based on the disease severity and consideration of underlying medical conditions. In COVID pandemic, since people got COVID in a large number, the anti-COVID drugs also were used in the mass level. So, through upcoming next exam point of view, all these drugs are very important. You may get questions on these drugs. Now, patient categories of disease severity with recommendation of treatments we will discuss here. Remember, these are the drugs which are used since last 1.5 years for the treatment of COVID-19. The second point which we need to remember is some of these drugs are currently being used and some of these drugs are not at all recommended. So what we are going to discuss is whatever drugs which are used till date, addition to that the drugs which are currently used. So here the disease severity is to be considered for the pharmacotherapy. Now the patients with underlying conditions such as diabetes, heart failure, end stage renal disease or immunosuppression are at increased risk for severe disease with ARDS and possible death. Information about drugs and protocol about anti-COVID drugs is rapidly evolving. So in this session, I will be only describing the pharmacological aspects of most of the popular drugs which are being used for COVID-19. One more important thing, see, the aim of our lecture is not recommending the drug or not recommending any treatment, but what we are going to discuss is previously recommended or currently recommended or not recommended drugs. So let's start our discussion with the disease severity. So let's talk about mild disease. In case of the mild disease, patient is not hospitalized and patient requires supportive care. If patient is hospitalized, in that case with SpO2 N94% or if there is a normal chest radiograph, again supportive treatment is required. Otherwise, we'll classify the patient into the moderate disease. In case of the moderate disease patient, hospitalized patient with SpO2 less than equal to 94 or radiographic evidences of pneumonia, the initial treatment may be hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin, or it was chloroquine if hydroxychloroquine was unavailable. So few cases or few reports are there where chloroquine is also used. In latter part of our discussion, we will discuss all these drugs. Doxycycline may be considered as an alternative for patients who demonstrate a hypersensitivity reaction to the azithromycin. So over the period of time, few of these drugs are not currently used. Even as we discuss, there is continuous change in the policies related to the drugs used for COVID-19. Next to that, let's talk about severe disease. Now, worsening respiratory function with CRS will go for the tocilizumab or sarilumab. For respiratory failure, we have a drug like remdesivir. Hydroxychloroquine must be discontinued prior to initiation of the remdesivir therapy because there will be a risk of QT prolongation. We have a choice of plasma and corticosteroids, but corticosteroids are only for refractory septic shock or ARDS. Now let's talk about the pharmacologic therapy which are considered for the treatment of COVID-19. In this, the first what we are going to discuss is antiviral drugs. So in the antivirals, the important drug here is remdesivir. Now remdesivir is nucleotide analog which is incorporated into viral RNA chain and results in premature chain termination. Remember, it is an experimental drug that has demonstrated antiviral activity against several RNA viruses, say for example Ebola, SARS and MERS, in vitro as well as in some non-human primate studies. If we see mechanism of action, the nucleotide analog that is incorporated into the viral RNA chain and results in premature chain termination. If we see the important adverse effect of this drug, there is gastrointestinal distress, elevated transaminase, and infusion site reaction. One important thing about adverse effect, since the pharmacovigilance studies of this drug is going on, so over the period of time, we may find few other adverse effects. If we see the current recommendation related to this drug is considered for patients with severe disease and respiratory failure. The next drug which we are going to discuss is favipiravir. Now favipiravir is a nucleoside analog which inhibits viral RNA polymerase and was initially intended for the treatment of RNA viruses such as Ebola and influenza. In one reported randomized controlled trial, it was found that favipiravir had a higher clinical recovery rate and produced a statistically significant reduction in the duration of fever when compared with the other drugs or even other antiviral drugs which are used for the treatment of influenza infection. So in some countries, these studies are reported. If we see mechanism of action, this drug is nucleoside analog which inhibit viral RNA polymerase. If we see the adverse effect of this drug, so there is abnormal transaminase, then there is a psychiatric symptoms, gastrointestinal discomfort, and there will be elevated serum uric acid after prolonged use of this drug. If we see the current recommendation, now recommendations related to these drugs are controversial. Why? Because across the globe, in some countries, the drug is not recommended, while few other countries, the drug is being used. In India, this drug is currently under use. The next drug which we are going to discuss is ribavirin. Now ribavirin, which is typically used in the treatment of the HCV and RSV, it was initially considered as a possible therapy for the treatment of COVID-19. However, subsequent studies have shown that the doses required for effective antiviral activity may have potentially fatal adverse effect such as hemolytic anemia, and thereby use of this drug or rather clinical use of this drug is limited. Ribavirin are not currently recommended for the treatment of the patients with COVID-19. If we see the mechanism of this drug, so it is guanosine analog that interferes with the viral replication. And the adverse effect of this drug is a hemolytic anemia. If we see the current recommendations, the drug is not currently recommended. The next drug which we are going to discuss is lopinavir and ritonavir. The combination of lopinavir and ritonavir is typically used for the treatment of human immunodeficiency virus or HIV virus infection. However, it has been noted that lopinavir has in vitro activity against coronavirus. So, ritonavir is also a protease inhibitor, but its primary role is to boost lopinavir concentrations and prolong the half-life of the lopinavir. This is why cytochrome P450 inhibition. If we see the mechanism of action of these drugs, so protease inhibition that prevent production of active viral peptides is a basic mechanism behind its activity. If we see the adverse effect, gastrointestinal distress, QT prolongation, and there are some drug-drug interactions which are specifically reported for ritonavir. As I told you, ritonavir interfere with the cytochrome P450 inhibition. If we see the current recommendations, so these drugs are not currently recommended. The next drug which we are going to discuss is oseltamivir. Now, oseltamivir, initially it is used for patients with COVID-19, but later on many studies suggested that the drug is not a suitable candidate for patients with COVID-19. So all these are the antiviral drugs which are used, or few of them are currently used for the treatment of COVID-19. So point to be noted with antiviral drug that remdesivir and favipiravir are the drugs which are currently used. Other drugs are not currently recommended. Next we are going to discuss, there are some anti-malarial drugs which used for the treatment of COVID-19. In that, the first is a chloroquine. Now, chloroquine and its derivative, that is hydroxychloroquine, have traditionally been used for the treatment of malaria and certain autoimmune diseases. However, the drug have possible activity against SARS-CoV-1 and SARS-CoV-2 in vitro and in clinical practices respectively. A study which is conducted in 2005 found that chloroquine's ability to elevate endosomal pH and therefore inhibit pH dependent steps in the viral replication process was effective, and due to this the drug is one of the important drug. Now let's see the mechanism of action for chloroquine. So here chloroquine, it elevates endosomal pH and inhibits pH dependent steps in the viral replication process. If we see the adverse effect of the chloroquine, so there is electrolyte imbalance, retinal damage on prolonged use, and fetal dysrhythmias are few adverse effect. Regarding its current recommendation, may be used as an alternative if hydroxychloroquine is not available. If we see the current recommendation in India, chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine, they are not currently recommended and not currently used. The next drug is hydroxychloroquine. Now the studies have found that hydroxychloroquine has increased potency and more tolerability and safety profile when compared with the chloroquine. If we see the mechanism of action for hydroxychloroquine, it elevates endosomal pH and inhibits pH dependent steps in the viral replication process. So the mechanism is same as that of the chloroquine. Regarding its adverse effect, there is electrolyte imbalance, fatal dysarrhythmias are reported. Regarding current recommendation of this drug, so previously the combination treatment with azithromycin was recommended, and this treatment was recommended for the patients with moderate to severe disease. But subsequent studies of hydroxychloroquine don't recommend use of this drug. So this is all about the antimalarial drugs which are used for the treatment of COVID-19. The third class of drug, or the third category. So here we have the drug ivermectin. Now ivermectin is an anti-parasite medication. So this drug is used to treat the head lice, onchocerciasis, strongyloidiasis, ascariasis, trichuriasis and enterobiasis. Now if we see the adverse effect of this drug, so there is a dizziness, loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting, stomach pain or bloating, diarrhea, constipation and weakness are reported. Regarding its current recommendation, the recommendations related to this drug are controversial. WHO advises that ivermectin only be used to treat COVID-19 within the clinical trials. In India, the drug is currently used. Now, the next class of drug or next category of drug is corticosteroids. Now, corticosteroids are often used for their anti-inflammatory effects in the patients with respiratory infections, several studies have indicated that the use of corticosteroids in patient with COVID-19 is associated with delayed viral clearance, high risk of the secondary infection and increased risk of mortality. Still, the use of corticosteroid may be indicated in patients who develop ARDS or refractory septic shock and those with underlying respiratory conditions such as asthma or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Regarding its mechanism of action, it binds to cytoplasmic receptors to change the transcription of mRNA and reduce production of inflammatory mediators. Regarding adverse effect of this class of drug, so avascular necrosis, psychosis, hyperglycemia, adrenal suppression, these are some major adverse effect. The one more major problem associated with the use of this drug are increased incidence of mucormycosis. So in case of mucormycosis, the drug of choice is amphotericin B. Regarding its current recommendation, it's only indicated for patients with refractory septic shock or severe ARDS. These drugs are not recommended for routine use. Now here, should not be used solely for the treatment of COVID-19 infection, but may be required to treat other condition that may be associated with COVID-19. The next class of drug is biologics. Now these are the biological drugs. So here the first is tocilizumab and sarilumab. Now tocilizumab and sarilumab, these are monoclonal antibodies against the interleukin-6 receptor that are currently being considered for use in patients with the COVID-19, especially patients who develop cytokine release syndrome, that is CRS. So it may have a potential role in severe and life-threatening illness. The proposed efficacy of this treatment involves the attenuation of the potentially fatal inflammatory response by reducing the cytokine concentration and inhibiting the production of acute phase reactants. regarding mechanism of action, so basically these are monoclonal antibody against interleukin 6 receptor. Regarding adverse effect of this class of drug, so abnormal transaminase, gastrointestinal perforation, neutropenia, infusion reactions are reported. Regarding its current recommendation, so this drug may be considered in patients with evidence of CRS and worsening of respiratory function. The second drug or the second treatment here is convalescent plasma. Now, passive immunization has been used to treat viral infection in patients who are unable to develop an adequate immune response, such as infants born to mother with active hepatitis B virus infection. Now, the same principle or same hypothesis is used over here. A meta-analysis of studies investigating the use of plasma for the treatment of SARS-CoV-1 and MERS-CoV found a significant reduction in mortality and viral load with no immediate adverse event. Initially, the FDA has approved the use of plasma for the treatment of severe and immediately life-threatening COVID-19 infections, and there are currently several trials which are being conducted, few studies which are reported, the recommendations again controversials. If we see the mechanism of action, so this is nothing but a passive immunization using a plasma from recovered patients. If we see the adverse effect of this, so there may be hypersensitivity reaction and there may be serum sickness. So as I told you, recommendations are controversial and may be considered in patient with worsening clinical conditions refractory to the other treatment. Some guidelines suggest against its use in critically ill patients, stating that the target levels of neutralizing antibody titers against the SARS-CoV-2 are unknown, while there are some studies which consider its use. The next class of drug is NSAID, that is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. NSAIDs work by inhibiting the cyclooxygenase, so it inhibits the COX-1 and COX-2, and thereby it blocks the production of prostaglandin, which are important mediators of fever and inflammation. The mechanism by which NSAID increases ACE2 expression is not well understood. However, fever has been reported one of the most common clinical manifestation of COVID-19, and NSAID such as ibuprofen are often used for their antipyretic activity. Further, anti-inflammatory effect of these drugs are well known. Although there is a lack of evidence supporting that the potential risk of NSAID which is used in the patients of the COVID-19, it may be prudent to use alternative antipyretic medications such as acetaminophen until more concentrate data is available. If we see mechanism of action of these drugs, these are well known. They block COX-1 and COX-2 and they inhibit production of the prostaglandin, and their adverse effects are mostly related to the gastrointestinal system. There is ulcer, there is bleeding, and sometimes there is a upregulation of the ACE2 receptors. Regarding its current recommendation, as such, there is no evidence of its antiviral activity against SARS-CoV-2, but it may be used for its anti-inflammatory and antipyretic effect. Moreover, aspirin may be used, so the low dose of aspirin regimen is recommended for primary prevention of arterial thromboembolism in patients who are at high risk of developing atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. The next class of drug is a renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system antagonist. So at this time, there is no clinical evidence suggesting that ACE inhibitor or ARBs increases susceptibility to SARS-CoV-2 or increase risk for the severe disease in those who are already infected. In fact, abruptly discontinuing treatment with this antihypertensive medicine or switching to other hypertension medications may increase the risk of adverse clinical outcomes which are associated with uncontrolled hypertension. If we see the current recommendations, these medications should not be routinely discontinued. Consider clinical conditions of individual patient before there is any change, any modification in the hypertensive treatment regimens. So these are the drugs which are used for the treatment of COVID-19. As we discussed, few of these drugs are not currently recommended, while few others are currently being used. So the drug like remdesivir, favipiravir, ivermectin, these drugs are currently used, while chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, these are the drugs which used initially. Ritonavir, lopinavir, in some part of the world, across the globe, these drugs are used, but currently, again, these drugs are not used. So these are all about the drugs which used or currently being used for the treatment of COVID-19.